I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Debunking Professor Dumb Dave, Episode 5. Now, as you all know, I usually start the episodes out with reviewing Professor Dumb Dave's reviews, but as I showed you in Episode 4, he has went in and deactivated the reviews, and we can't take a look at them now. As you can see down here at the bottom, the option is not even there anymore. And of course, those of you who left comments in the comment sections of his videos, he went in and deleted those out, so I'm not able to show those either. So what I am going to do for you in this episode is debunk 2 of Professor Dumb Dave's challenges. Now, we've already debunked 1, 2, 3, and 4 of his challenges. So in this episode, we're going to be debunking challenge 5 and challenge 6. So let's begin with debunking Professor Dumb Dave's 5 challenge.
This time, I'd like to offer some challenges to you remaining few that are desperately clinging to this dying fad to derive some semblance of self-worth. Let's call them
10 challenges for flat earthers.
5, speaking of things that are far away, you all love whipping out your Nikons so much that I wouldn't be surprised if a Nikon executive dreamt up the entire flat earth hoax as a viral marketing campaign.
Okay, first of all, we can tell that Professor Dumb Dave has no experience with cameras whatsoever, just by him not even being able to pronounce the name of the camera correctly.
You all love whipping out your Nikons.
Okay, Dumb Dave, it's called a Nikon, not a Nikon. Even Siri should know that. Let's check and see. Hello, Siri.
Go ahead.
What does N-I-K-O-N spell?
Nikon. N-I-K-O-N.
Okay, now I know I didn't have to do that, but this guy claims to be a professor. You would think he would know how to pronounce a 5-letter word. And for someone who has supposedly made hundreds of videos and gets on here and schools people about filming and operating with cameras, you would think he would know how to pronounce the name of the camera correctly. Especially one of the most popular cameras there is. But anyways, let's move on.
You take a boat that's far away, pull it back into focus, and then marvel at your own brilliance for figuring out how to operate a camera. Well, try this one then. Stay on the boat. Don't cut away. Stay on it until it disappears. How will it disappear? Bottom up, just like everything else. I wonder why you've never put that on YouTube.
Okay, listen to the question again.
Stay on the boat. Don't cut away. Stay on it until it disappears. How will it disappear?
Okay, once again, either Professor Dumb Dave is lying to you and trying to deceive you, or he is really this dumb. So he's saying keep the camera on the boat, and then he's asking how will it disappear? Okay, before we even zoom in on a boat with a camera, let's remember the fact that ever since we were children, we've been taught that when you look out across the ocean with a naked eye and all of a sudden the boat disappears out of your view, we've been taught that it goes over the curvature of the earth and that's why you cannot see it no more. And that's just with the naked eye alone. We've been taught that since 1492. Let's let your astrophysicist, Neil deGrasse Tyson, explain that really quick.
So, Neil, you're not a climate scientist, but you're a very distinguished scientist and astrophysicist.
Hey, what's up, Neil? I got, like, a super important question for you that I've been wondering, like, my whole life. Okay, is the world round or flat? Because if so, if the world is round, why isn't the water falling out into the space, out into space?
Mikhail, you ask a very important question. This concept had eluded all of humanity for centuries. Everyone thought Earth was flat. Why? Because it looked flat. and they pose the same arguments you did. If it was round, stuff would fall off on the other side. You can't have people standing upside down on a round Earth. Here's the thing. We thought Earth was flat before we had sea-going vessels that went beyond the horizon, recognizing that there has to be a curve there, because the ship doesn't always stay in view. So Columbus, when he set sail, the ship eventually disappeared. And you can chase after him, and you can keep disappearing. You can keep doing this. This would count as evidence that Earth's surface was curved.
Okay, since Columbus supposedly set sail in 1492, ever since then, we've been taught that when you can't see the boat anymore with your naked eye, that it has disappeared over the curvature of the Earth. Now, before one of the Globers jumps in and says, oh, they looked at it through telescopes back then. Well, it would have been impossible to watch Columbus sail over the curvature of the Earth in 1492 when the first telescope wasn't even invented until 1608. So, like I said, for 500 years, we've been taught that when you cannot see the boat anymore with your naked eye, that it went over the curvature of the Earth. So, just how far away can a person see with the naked eye? The average is about 3 miles, but let's ask Google for those who don't know. Generally, an average height person can see up to 4.5 kilometers. 2.8 miles at sea level. Okay, now let me show you what that looks like. Okay, now here I have some of my Nikon P900 footage. But before we look for the boat with the P900, I want you to understand that right here is 3 miles out. That's as far as you can see with the naked eye. And that would be what they call the vanishing point, which I'll show you right here. Vanishing point. Number one, the point at which receding parallel lines viewed in perspective appear to converge. Now, the vanishing point here would be where the sky meets the water. You can't see beyond that. That is your vanishing point. Number two, the point at which something that has been growing smaller or increasingly faint disappears altogether. Now, what that means is if you watch a boat go out to sea, and if you keep watching that boat, it would eventually get smaller and smaller until it disappears beyond the limit of your vision, which is called the vanishing point. The point where you can't see any further with the naked eye. So they've told us for 500 years that the boat goes over the curvature of the Earth, beyond the vanishing point, beyond our line of sight. Now, remembering when they taught us this 500 years ago, that telescopes hadn't been invented yet. And when they told us this 500 years ago, they never knew that 500 years later, we would have a camera to where we could zoom in past that vanishing point, beyond the line of sight of the naked eye, the point where they told us the boat goes over the curvature of the Earth. So let's see if the boat disappears over the curvature of the Earth once it goes beyond the vanishing point like they told us for 500 years. And we're gonna do that by zooming in with the Nikon P900. As you can see, there's no boat at all. You can't see it with the naked eye. But watch this. It supposedly went over the curvature of the Earth. But let's zoom in and see.
Look at you. You're gonna choke on it too. You're gonna lose that smile. Because all the while, I could see for miles.
Okay, now you just watched a boat pop right back into view like it was right in front of us. The same boat that they told us went over the curvature of the Earth 500 years ago when we couldn't even see that far. So now that we can see that far, we see that the boat did not disappear over the curvature of the Earth like they told us that it did 500 years ago. So now that we have proven that it did not go over the curvature of the Earth, we have Professor Dumb Dave saying, keep the camera on the boat, keep the camera on the boat, and see if it disappears. Yes, Dumb Dave, it will disappear eventually because of the simple fact that this camera has a vanishing point to it, just like the naked eye had a vanishing point to it. This camera can only see so far away, and then the boat will disappear beyond the limit of the camera's vision, just as the boat disappeared beyond the limit of the vision of our naked eye did. That doesn't mean that it went over the curvature of the Earth. It means that it's going so far away that you cannot physically see it anymore. Now, if you still don't understand what I'm trying to tell you, let me break it down to you this way. Here, we have a high school football field. Okay, we have the goalie and we have the bleachers at the other end of this field, and we have the camera on the ground. So what I want you to picture here is that this guy's shorts that we're looking at here, picture his shorts being the boat. Now watch what happens to his shorts once he gets beyond the vanishing point, the limit of our vision. Now, need I say more? We all know that this football field doesn't have a big curve in it. If it did, it'd be one hell of a game, wouldn't it? The man's shorts disappear due to the law of perspective. The boat disappears due to the law of perspective. The vanishing point, it goes beyond the limit of our vision.
We thought Earth was flat before we had seagoing vessels that went beyond the horizon, recognizing that there has to be a curve there.
So, as you can see, that is a bunch of lying, deceiving bullcrap. And therefore, debunking Professor Dumb Dave's number 5 challenge. Now let's move on to challenge number 6.
Number 6. The most hilarious thing about Flat Earth is that the most mundane everyday observations make absolutely no sense in your model. Like a sunset. A small sun above a flat Earth would simply recede high in the sky and get smaller and smaller until it fades away.
Okay, once again, either Dumb Dave is lying and trying to deceive you, or he really is that dumb and doesn't understand the law of perspective. Now listen to what he says one more time.
Like a sunset. A small sun above a flat Earth would simply recede high in the sky and get smaller and smaller until it fades away.
And that's exactly what the sun would do on a flat Earth. Now here's the difference. In the winter solstice, the sun is further away from you. So when the sun sets, it will appear to get smaller the further that it moves away from you. Now, in the summer solstice, the sun is up close. It's making a small circuit. So, therefore, it will not appear to get smaller because it's not going very far away. So first, let me show you a sunset in the winter solstice when the sun is furthest away, and you will see that the sun appears to get smaller the further that it moves away from you. Now, before I do the time lapse of this sunset, I'm going to draw a circle around this sun of its position and size at midday, and then I'm going to take the same circle and put it around the sun right at sunset in the evening. And you will see the difference in size. Okay, now you just seen with your own eyes the sun appear to get smaller the further that it moved away. And I didn't even have to put the circle on there to prove that. I just did that in case you double dumb and double blind. Therefore, debunking the first part of your challenge. Now let's move on to the second part of challenge number 6.
It absolutely would not retain the same angular size and set below the horizon.
Yes, it absolutely would appear to stay the same size in the summer solstice because the sun is in close, making a small circuit. So therefore, it's not moving out away from you. So it's not going to appear to get much smaller in size, as I will demonstrate for you here. As you can see, we have a string tied from one end of the counter to the other in a straight and level line with a level sun moving across a flat earth being viewed from above. Now let's look at the same scene viewed from the perspective of standing on the flat earth with the box of bottles acting as our horizon line. So I just showed you that in the winter solstice, how the sun appears to get smaller and smaller the further that it moves away from you. And in the summer solstice, as the sun sets behind the horizon, it doesn't appear to change in size very much at all. Therefore, debunking the second part of challenge number 6. Now, let's move on with the rest of the challenge.
It stays the same size because it's unbelievably far away, and it sets below the horizon because the Earth is a sphere that is turning. Even a toddler can understand this. It's so blatantly obvious that you have to resort to your typical ad hoc antics, talking about refractive effects that defy all logic and somehow magically apply to the sun but nothing else.
Like I said, we just debunked all the bullcrap that he just sat there and said, and it didn't have anything to do with refraction. Simple observation and science.
Why does nothing else but the sun behave that way? Show me a projectile or a plane going below the horizon as it recedes.
Okay, we already did that earlier in the video, but just in case you didn't see it really, really good, here it is for you to see again. Now let's finish this up.
Do something to explain a sunset. Do anything besides making idiotic videos with action movie soundtracks that contradict middle school level science.
Okay, now he's just repeating himself over and over. We did explain it to you, dumb Dave, with middle school level science, which apparently you still can't figure out. Being that you are going for your master's degree in chemistry for a third time in life after failing twice already. And with that being said, we have debunked Professor Dumdave's challenge number 6. And being that we debunked challenge number 5 and number 6 here in episode 5, be sure to join me in episode 6 where we debunk Professor Dumdave's challenge number 7. Everyone, thanks for watching. Have a good evening and God bless.
All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing.